There's a couple of songs you picked, Gary. Just tell us how they fit into your life. Four Strong Winds.
Yeah, okay. Four Strong Winds is a song that I think it's one of the first songs I learned on guitar, actually. But I'm a bit of a mountain man. I love the references back to the mountains and this particular one, Alberta, and all that. I think it's just a beautiful song. I know it's been adapted by the Canadians as almost a national song. And I think that's... It's just a wonderful song. It's not too hard. It's not too deep, but it just talks about, it talks about the mountains and coming back to the mountains and all that sort of stuff.
G'day, Gary, and everyone else out there watching. I've got a little song here that I learned was one of your favourites, so I thought I'd give it a go.
You were both playing at the peaks of your career at the time of the biggest revolution in cricket, and that was Kerry Packer's World Series. And I'm pretty certain that Tony Gregg was recruiting players during the Centenary Test that we're talking about. So were either or both of you approached by Gregg to join Packer at that stage?
Not during the Centenary Test match, no. Greggy was, I'll tell you, he was a very genuine, very brave man, was Tony Gregg. And he thought, no, this is a very special occasion. We'll leave it, and he never even gave that a thought. He loved the game of cricket, and I never approached. I was approached later on, but not during that period. No.
I was reading online. This was a quote in a Wikipedia post that you said that there was brown paper envelopes handed out during the Centenary Test amongst the Australian team. Is that correct?
Yeah, I was sitting beside Hooksy, and they were giving out a movie theatre tickets. And I thought, well, I'm usually a good team man, and we always are usually left out of team of what's going on here.
Maybe you're going to see Out of Africa, and you're going to be into it.
I didn't really think anything about it apart from that. I haven't got any tickets. And then, yeah, Hooksy was a good friend of mine. And yeah, but I'd played that. I think the Centenary Test was my ninth test. So I played for nearly 2 years with everybody, you know, in that team. And at that stage, before my two horrendous innings that I played, thank you for not showing them. I was averaging 40-odd, right? So Hooksy and I got on the plane, and this was the famous tour that Rod Marsh decided that he'd have a few drinks on the way to England, where he drank his 52 cans. So Hooksy and I sat beside each other, and we drank, you know, those little bottles they used to have on the planes of gin and all that sort of stuff. Yeah. Hooksy and I drank 18 before we got to Singapore. So we were asleep for most of the trip after that, and then we got out, and so beside through the whole thing, he didn't mention anything, right? And when it all broke after Tony Gregg's party, Arkell, you remember that at Bath, that we were all at, oh, were you there after the Bath match? Were you at that party?
No.
Oh, okay, because it was a local county game, and so we had a. Yeah, we all came back to the hotel, and the next morning, myself and Greg Dimmick came down to breakfast, and we went past the bar, and our manager, Len Maddox, and Alan McGilvray, the wonderful, famous commentator, were in the bar early. Even for them, it was a little early. It was about 8:30, and we thought, what the hell's going on here? So I went up to them and said, what's going on? And they said, you better go up to the breakfast room and talk to your mates. So I went up to the breakfast room, and everybody was around their tables, and I looked at Hooksy. I said, what's going on? And he said, well, I didn't know if you're in or you're out, and we couldn't tell anybody. And I said, you couldn't tell anybody what? And then we had this sort of discussion in front of everybody, and it was a pretty difficult moment for for everybody. And, of course, you know, the tour from that stage was a very difficult one. We got thrashed by the English team. There was a wonderful team, but as
they brought boycott back, that was a difference.
It was a wonderful team until you brought him back, and then but as a team, we really struggled for coherence in any direction, and everybody thought that they were, I think, we're going to be able to play these side matches and then still play for Australia. And then eventually they found out that, well, that may not happen. And then it became really difficult. And everybody was glad the tour was over in the finish, even though they didn't know what they were going back to.
Yeah, it was very sad, wasn't it, at the time? I thought it was going to ruin the game completely at the time. As it turned out, it was probably the best thing for the game, wasn't it?
So, Derek,
you say you were approached or invited, and I'm assuming you turned it down because you didn't play World Series cricket.
Bob Willis and myself met Richie Beno, and we had a good chat about it. But I felt, I still wanted to try and play for England, really. And I didn't really feel part of that at all. It didn't seem right for me, so I just managed to play a few more test matches for England, which I'm very grateful for, really, because a lot of the players who went to Packer weren't allowed to play, so it gave other people more opportunity, really.
More recently, I've discovered Guy Clark, and probably not until after he died, actually, and that's the reason why I discovered him. I heard it on the radio, and they said, this guy, Guy Clark, died, and they played a song. I thought, wow, what a fabulous song. So I've investigated Guy Clark a bit more and just found out how much he is appreciated by all the really strong country players, Willie Nelson and Christopherson and all those guys. Yeah, Stuff That Works is the song that I mentioned, and it's all about stuff that when you're not feeling so good, it's the stuff that you hold on to. And we all, maybe a lot of us are going through that at the moment, but it's a nice song, and it gets a bit deep, and I think it's okay.
G'day, Gary. I believe you're a bit of a Guy Clark fan, and so am I. I know most of his songs, and I believe this is a bit of a favourite of yours. I hope you enjoy it. And I'd like to say before I sing it, thanks for catching Randall, because as a 9-year-old, listening to him run away with the game was actual torture. So you ended England's fairy tale and created a fairy tale for us, and I really appreciate that all these years on. You've probably heard that before, but thank you. Stuff that works, Guy Clark. I got an old blue shirt, suits me just fine. I like the way it feels, so I wear it all the time. Got an old guitar, won't ever stay in tune. I like the way it feels in a dark and empty room. Got an old pair of boots and they fit just right. I can work all day and I can dance all night. I've got an old used car and it runs just like a top. Got a feeling it ain't ever gonna stop. Stuff that works, stuff that holds up, the kind of stuff you don't hang on the wall. Stuff that's real, stuff you feel, the kind of stuff you reach for when you fall. Got a pretty good friend who's seen me at my worst. He can't tell if I'm a blessing or a curse. But he always turns up when the chips are down. That's the kind of stuff I like to be around. Stuff that works, stuff that holds up, the kind of stuff you don't hang on the wall. Stuff that's real, stuff you feel, kind of stuff you reach for when you fall. She's crazy, paints like God. She got a playground sense of justice, she won't take odds. I got a tattoo with her name right through my soul. I think everything she touches turns to gold. Stuff that works, stuff that holds up, kind of stuff you don't hang on the wall. Stuff that's real, stuff you feel, the kind of stuff you reach for when you fall. Stuff that works. Thanks for listening.
The two reasons World Series happened was, one, Packer wanted the TV rights in Australia, but the other was apparently that Test players and probably county players and probably state players in Australia were very poorly paid.
Yeah.
I'm just curious with both you, and I'll start with Derek. What was the pay like, and did you actually manage to make a living just from cricket, or did you have to do other things to get by?
You didn't. Well, to be honest, you didn't play cricket for the money. You played for the love of the game. There's nothing better. Now, what could be better? You know, it opens up all sorts of different things for people in their life, and nothing better than playing cricket. So no matter, pay was irrelevant as long as you could afford to see your way through, really. But yep. Nowadays it's amazing, isn't it? You know, they get paid an absolute fortune for playing 20 over cricket. I can't believe it. I could have continued to play until I was 70.
What else did you do to earn a living and to make ends meet?
I wasn't as prolific as Garry, but I sold a few flowers to start with, a few Australian dried flowers as well. Sold a bit of printing. So I did all sorts of bits and bobs. But I finished up doing quite a bit of coaching at with the universities, which I enjoyed, really.
Yeah. And Garry, what was it like for you?
You weren't bowling coach, were you, Uncle?
No, I wasn't even batting coach.
Okay, so for us, and we didn't play the amount of cricket that the English guys did, right? If you were a shield cricketer, you played 8 or 9 games a year, and then hopefully you played for Australia. There wasn't any one day, so you played state games. So back in 77, I think for 4 days of shield cricket, we got about $25. And for a test match, we just went to 400. The thing happened before the Centenary Test. We signed an agreement with, as it was back then, Benson and Hedges as the major sponsor. Times have changed a bit. We were paid $200 plus a little bit into the Provident Fund, and then it went to $400 for that next series, which was against the English. So I know. When we went to England we got there in April, left there in September, we got $12,000.
Great trip though, mate, wasn't it? I bet you enjoyed it, didn't you?
Well, it rained for 6 weeks. I didn't get a rain for 6 weeks, I tell you what.
You should be here now. We have 3 days of over 30 degrees and then it rains for a week after that. The weather's changed completely.
There are a few pints that went down in that first 12. The 6 weeks, I can tell you, but now times have changed a little, and I think the athleticism with the cricket's wonderful. We were just in that transitional period, and back here in Australia, we were as much in the middle of it as anybody else. And then when players came back into state cricket, it was really difficult. A lot of players went by the way. Really, really good players were lost in that changeover from the World Series guys that came back, and to the ones around the edges of World Series, to the really good players. And one person I'll mention all this is a chap who played for Australia and for New South Wales, Peter Toohey. And Peter Toohey was a fantastic cricketer. I mean,
middle order batter, wasn't he?
He was a great batter. He was a wonderful cover fielder. He batted a bit like Mark Waugh, you know. He didn't look spectacular. He just got runs and runs. When the World Series came back, Peter just sort of, you know, drifted away from cricket. He wasn't being picked. And there are a lot of really, really good players that went by the wayside. And that was a bit strange. So at the age of 26, I decided to give it away because it was all very political and a little bit hard back here.
That era you're just talking about, where the official Australian team, which some people call the second 11, first Graham Yallop and then Kim Hughes and then Bobby Simpson.
Alan Border.
Well, Border was discovered then, wasn't he? Yeah. Some fantastic matches. The series against India, every match was within about 20 runs.
That was fantastic. They brought back Bobby Simpson at the age of 42, who was still skilled enough to play against what Al McGilvray said was the best spin attack he had ever seen, Prasada, Beatty, Chandrasekhar, and then Venkat just to run and bowl a few. Simo, got runs against them. we won on the last day in Adelaide at 3-2, and it was a wonderful series. The worst thing it did was that I opened, and it made me stay as an opener for long. I never wanted to open the bloody batting.
Oh, yeah.
So it was a wonderful series, but it took those players. I think Bobby Simpson had played 60, 70, 80 tests, whatever Simo played. Then the next after that was Tomo at maybe 30 tests, and then it was me at 9 tests. So yeah. We were the three senior players. There was Harvey, senior player at nine tests. So then we went to the West Indies. And, of course, the West Indies kept in their pack of players for the first three tests. And they ran through us, you know, as it was with some substandard wickets as well, as you would imagine they would. And then put a lot of players to bed after that didn't really their careers. It was a very hard time for good players who were thrown into, you know, a situation where now, you know, players are given years to develop. They go to county cricket and make 12,000 runs and eventually maybe pick for Australia. They make 10,000 shield runs. Back then, if you were 22 or 23 and scored a couple of hundreds in shield cricket, then you were in the face of the Australian selectors and might get picked, you know. So the whole thing was, yeah. And then all of a sudden, those players were left as the senior players. So it was a very hard time for Australian cricket. And of course,
it did bring some great cricketers to the fore, didn't it? Fantastic career, like Alan Border.
The Australian selectors made their worst decision of all time. They dropped me and picked Alan Border. I mean, I can't believe
that. They dropped me and picked David Gower.
Jumping forwards 40 years and looking back, if you guys were both 40 years younger, would you enjoy playing T20?
Oh yeah, I think I might have got a game in T20, and I might have got a dollar for it as well. Unfortunately, you got to field really, really, really well, but I would have got away with it somewhere.
Yeah, I would have done as well. I'd have loved it, really. 20 over, imagine 20 overs, getting paid for 20 over cricket. It's amazing, isn't it? Instead of fielding for 3.5 days.
If you talk to Tomo about this, he's pretty angry about blokes bowling 4 overs and getting paid for
20 overs. I could imagine, oh, crikey.
So You mentioned Geoffrey Boycott earlier. I've just finished reading Fred Titmuss's autobiography, his second one. And when he was a selector and Boycott had been out of the team for a while, some Yorkshire fan came up to Titmuss, saw him in the street and said, oh, you could fix all of England's problems if you put Boycott back in the team. And Fred said, well, maybe, but unfortunately we don't have 10-day test matches.
Boycott.
I tell you what, the game that they brought him back for his 99th test was at Notts, wasn't it? I think Derek was playing with us. I wasn't in the game, but I was in the squad, and we were walking off, and it was packed. It was absolutely packed as we were coming off from the practice wickets, walking across the ground. And Geoffrey came up beside me. He said, hello, Coz. I said, yeah, the boy. He said, big crowd. I said, yeah, big crowd. He said, come to watch me, they have.
Well, yeah, they blooming had as well. Half of them were Yorkshiremen. Well, he didn't let them down, did he?
Yeah, no.
His 98th 100, he got a 100 at Headingley in the test match between. Then he got another 100 at Headingley in the test match. It was amazing, really. It was amazing. Yeah. I know you were in a bit of turmoil in the, but if it hadn't been for him and those three innings, it would have been a totally different series.
Yeah, no.
Just took some getting out, didn't it?
He didn't do it slowly, and he did it, you know, as with all the skill that he had, you know. I mean, he's you can say about him whatever you want to say about him, but he could really play cricket.
I did come across a clip in doing research for this. I'd never seen it before, Derek, or if I had, I'd forgotten about it, where you were batting with Geoffrey Boycott. And
he could bat, but he couldn't bloody run, I'll tell you that.
he could run to the other end of the pitch without checking to see if the other bat.
Oh my god, you're not kidding, he could.
But I loved it when I watched the clip, I watched it a couple of times. The way
Kieran, you're not gonna show that, are you?
He goes to the other end and he just stands there and goes, oh well, you're just gonna have to run. Obviously, it was annoying for you. In the moment, you can see the frustration on the clip. But how did that get squared away in the dressing room afterwards?
Well, he let me hit the winning hit in the at the end, which was very nice of him, really. But he said that's the best 100 he's ever scored in his life, Boycott, because if he'd have got out, the crowd would have bloody killed him. I'm telling you. But if you wanted somebody, I'll tell you, Gary, if you wanted somebody to back, get 50 for your life, I'd send him in, definitely. Right. Yeah. Just a fighter, a Backley, you know, made for Test cricket he was.
Derek, you came to Melbourne in 79, is that right?
Yeah,
to play for Prahran. So before I ask you about this, I just wanted to ask Gary, because, you know, I'm younger than all you guys. was obviously by the 80s, there was a lot of Australian players getting to go over to play county cricket. Was that not something that happened in the 70s so much?
Well, I don't know. No, because there wasn't that many agents in that in the 70s. Yeah, you got invited by whether the county club for example, I was playing in Adelaide. I got invited to go over there by Littlesborough, and it would have been 74, 75, I guess. And but because I needed a job back at home, I wasn't guaranteed of getting a job back at home. So I refused it. And then again, it's a bit like the Alan Border thing. They got Joel Garner. So how about it? But that was direct contact with the club back. And then when the 80s come on, you got agents involved, and it was more a job for more people.
You needed that third party to.
Yeah, well, the agents had a job, right? They were making money out of it, so you had people to do that for you. But previous to that, you just get a phone call from somebody.
I seem to think Australia, sometime during that period, they stopped people playing abroad.
It was after that. I don't know if they stopped everybody. I don't know, but there was, they thought that we were playing too much overseas, in England in particular. Yeah, that's right, in the 80s, Derek.
That was the 80s.
So, Derek, how did the situation arise that you came out to play for Prahran for that year?
Well, I got dropped from the England team, and you got to make a living, and I thought, well, better way to go and play in Australia. Fantastic. So I played a bit of cricket and had a bit of fun.
Did they contact you, or did you?
I can't honestly remember. It was such a long time ago, Kieran.
I'm just curious to know how daunting it is to walk into your national, your Australian and English cricket team for the first time as a player. Do you feel like a little boy, or do you actually know most of the players because you've been playing on the circuit with them?
After you, Derek.
Well, I walked into that. Well, Tony Gregg was captain of England, and he was just phenomenal. He was so brave and such a determined character. And then you've got wonderful cricket like Alan Knott, Derek Underwood, Bob Willis, They're just wonderful cricketers to be in. Just to sit next to them in that dressing room was just amazing. And be part of that team and be welcomed into the team was amazing, really. When I look back, I'm thinking, crikey, what am I doing here? It's just amazing. Fantastic. Great experience.
Gary?
Yeah, you do. Now, the only time I'd met Tomo before was playing against him, and he threatened to kill me every time I played against him. He was the first one to welcome me in, so that was nice. We had the transition time where Ian Chappell stood down as captain and Greg took over. So we still had some of the greats of Australian cricket. We had Ian Chappell was still there. Ian Redpath, it was his final series. We had, of course, Lilly, Thompson, Mallett, Rod Marsh, Dougie Walters, Rick McCosker, Alan Turner. It was a wonderful team. And they were fantastic. But it was also, it was a hard school. Nobody told you too much. You were there, you were expected to all of a sudden be an Australian player. And, you talked about bowling. I went out to the nets and thought I'd be pretty cool in front of about 60 or 70,000 people at 10 o'clock at at the Melbourne Cricket Ground. So I picked up the ball, let it go, and it went 20 rows over the top of the... I was bowling for South Australia at this stage. And I went straight over the net into a group of about 20 or 30 people right behind the buddy, behind the net. So that was... But you were just... They didn't tell you much, you know, and right. You were just expected to do it. Derek, was it the same for you?
The example the set was about, you could see the way they performed, the way they prepared. It just, it was a different level, wasn't it? So you could learn by just watching them, couldn't you? They were amazing, really.
Yeah, it was serious stuff.
Serious, they were amazing.
So, I'll ask both of you this, but Derek first, did anybody or any couple of people end up as your best mates in the team?
Well, Eddie Hemmings was a good mate of mine, and I remember rooming with Norman Cowans. He was only 19 at the time, a young West Indian, because you shared with different roomies all the time, and he's built beautifully, you know, he had rippling muscles, and he used to get up in the morning, look in the mirror at his body and all that. I used to stay in bed so he didn't see mine until he got out the bloody room, you know. But they were all different, you know, you room with everybody, they were all magnificent, really, all different characters, fantastic. Just great to be part of it, really. I miss all that, really. Time in the dressing room was special.
I can still remember Eddie Hemmings coming in as a night watchman. Was back in 82 or 83 in Melbourne.
Yeah, I do remember it.
Yeah,
didn't I was batting with him.
He fall short of 100 by just a few runs?
96 he got. It was amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
Amazing. Yeah. And he was given caught behind off his pad as well, you know. He wasn't even out when he was given out. So if he could have had replays, he would have got a test 100. Fantastic. So
Gary, who became your best mates in the team?
Look, I'm still pretty close with Tomo. Hooksy was a mate. I was best man at his wedding and all that. So obviously that stays with me for a long time.
Yeah.
Maxie Walker was, became, but these are all pretty
Victorians.
Pretty easy to get on with, you know. I mean, really, big tangles and, now, Hooksy wasn't that easy. He was a bit edgy, but I got on okay with him. Jeff Thompson is very easy to get on with. He just had a knee operation, actually, last week. Rod Marsh was the sort of guy that will stay friends forever because he was a really decent, honest, hard-working person who doesn't care how good or how not good you were, but if you're a decent bloke, he'll treat you exactly the same. So, we'll stay friends forever. We had a Centenary Test thing just last year that you could, no, sorry, 2 years ago that you couldn't come out for, Derek, obviously. We had Bobby Willis was there. They wheeled us out and they drove us around the MCG just a couple of years ago, 40th anniversary, I think it was, and there was 8 or 9 of us there, and with Bobby as well, which was nice to have Bobby, back in the group before he wasn't in the group.
So you've got to be the youngest then, out of both teams.
Yeah, Ian Davis, who looks 93 and doesn't have a head, he's probably the youngest by about 2 months, but you'd never know. So
he's got no hair, has he?
He looks like Uncle Fester out of the Adams family.
I hope you know him pretty well.
He doesn't live too far away. We're sort of locked in time because of this game. The guys that played in it, and no matter what our performances were, from Derek down to me. We're locked in time a bit, and may we be ever, kept that way.
Yeah, lovely.
I reckon. I've got a couple of quick questions. Do you reckon the camaraderie between teams was easier and better back then than it is these days? Like, were the drinks in the dressing room together after every day's play?
I don't think it's any different, to be honest. I think there's a lot more camaraderie between each individual team, because especially the England team, they're brought together on central contract, so they spend all their time together, especially in lockdown. Now they've had about 5 weeks, 6 weeks together. They haven't seen their wives, they haven't seen their kids. But, it must have been amazing for them, really. Tough, but amazing to spend that time together as a team. So they spend more time together as teams. But I'm not quite so sure after the game. I don't know, really.
Feedback I get is that they don't do too much after the game. They get in their ice baths and they get their rub downs and they all that sort of stuff. And then they go back. They have someone pick up their bags for them and put them in their. They go back to their hotels. When we played, the English team had some terrific personalities, and so did we. And the Mike Hendricks and and Oldie and Both and all those guys who were the first in your rooms with a drink or vice versa, it was a wonderful time. And that's where you learnt most of your cricket, not out in the practice nets. It was terrific. I don't know if that happens quite so much anymore. I doubt it, actually.
Yeah.
And was the sledging any more or any less back then than it seems to be today?
Oh, we've got stump mics. I mean, God, could you imagine?
Can't say anything.
I don't think anybody would be playing, or you'd have to forfeit your whole match.
Imagine Ian Chappell. $25. He'd cost him a fortune, wouldn't it?
Well, Ian Chappell had a best of your life sort of thing the other day and said that he didn't know anybody that sleds very much on the field, and he thought it was all very quiet as far as he was concerned, which is just like a crap I've ever heard.
Oh, dear.
It was pretty much full on. If you, I don't think, if you're a weak link, then you copped it. If you backed away and you weren't brave and showed a little chink in your armour, then they would let you, certainly the Australians would let you know. But if they respected you as a cricketer, then they wouldn't say anything. And us in our team, where you were young and in the team, you were just expected to shut up and play cricket. And the only people that would say anything was a Lily or a Marsh or a Greg or an Ian Chappell, maybe an Ashley Mallett, but the rest were just there to do their job and shut up and play cricket, you know. There was a hierarchy within the team, and you would never say anything against anybody who was better than you. That was a silly thing to do.
I don't remember Rodney Marsh saying anything. All that power that he had behind those stumps, I don't remember him saying much at all, really.
When you make 74, Derek, there's not too much you can say, really.
Pardon?
There was
not when you make 174, there's not too much.
There was an apocryphal story I read about Rodney Marsh, that he was fond of putting stakes in the keeping gloves to form a cushion between.
He had to after. That was the first series when Tomo started playing, and he had to pad his gloves with something. And I think he did put some raw, I don't know if they were a whole steak, but there were certainly cuts of raw meat inside his gloves.
So did that, I always wondered, did that mean on a particularly hot day, if he was coming in?
And there were no slips, or leg slips, or short legs.
But if he's a hell of a lot of thighs. Surely the bats. When you were batting, Derek, did you ever go, what's that smell?
I've got no sense of smell, mate. I'm all right. I've got no sense of taste, really. I'm lucky. I've been married to Liz for about 40 odd years, and she's not the best of cooks anyway. So I'm all right.
Okay. Well,
I think that's why she married me.
Yeah, Derek.
Hey. She's not going to hear, Gary. You're all right.
So, to start to wrap things up a little bit, I probably know the answer to this question from Derek, because you wouldn't be aware of this, Gary, but Derek and myself appeared in a commercial together back in 79, and that obviously we will end up being a part of his career, putting a great big tin of fruit on his head to resemble Ned Kelly, and I'm doing some of the best acting that's probably been seen on the small screen in that time. But what have been your so first, Garry? What have been your if I you to pick a highlight from your time in cricket, and it can be anything. Have you got? Does anything come to mind?
Yeah, look, it does actually, and I'll try and cut the story short. But actually, Arkell was there for this. In the Centenary Test, which I'd come into the MCG scoring 200s at that game in the two games before, John Lever got me out twice within 24 hours playing the same stupid bloody hook shot straight in and up in the air, batting number three, right? So then it got to the stupid stage where I batted once against John in the nets when I was ready to open the batting in Brisbane, where there was nobody, our players weren't around. And he said, oh, I have a bowl to you. He bowled me first ball. And I was about to open up against him in the in about an hour's time. So ridiculous, right? So anyway, I got dropped out of the team for that stupid bloke, Alan Border. And then they brought me back for the one-day games. Right. And I knew that it was at the MCG, and I knew that and we hadn't won anything. Right. The Poms are smashing us. We hadn't won anything. And I knew that when I come out to bat, that they'd bring John on to bowl for me. And I was watching him and I was batting six, and I was watching him bowl, and he bowled a couple of overs. And I noticed that his first ball was a really slow warm up ball. It was, you know. And I thought, well, bugger this. When I go out there and he comes on, it's first ball or nothing, right? So anyway, so happens I got a few quick runs. I got, you know, like 12 off about five balls or something like that. And then in comes JK. And I thought, well, this is because we've got the World Cup's about to happen. And I thought, if I get none here again, that's it, done. So anyway, so he bowls. And I hit it into the second row of the members' stands.
Which are big.
To the southern stand, and they're going crazy, right? We've finally got a chance to win a game, you know, for all summer. And I only made 28 off about 10 or 11 balls. Wasn't very much. But we got up and we won the game. So, yeah, I got some hundreds and all that sort of stuff. But that moment was a defining moment for me, because I thought, it's now or never. And fortunately,
I think you hit two sixes as well. I remember picking one straight out there. Oh, that's hell of a hit in Melbourne, isn't it, as well?
Yeah. It just hit just under the clock in the member stand.
What's that? It's about 100 yards, isn't it? I was just thinking, if the Adelaide, straight hit at Adelaide, if you'd ever hit a six there at Adelaide. I couldn't even see the boundary at Adelaide when I played.
To play against the Englishman with Derek Randall on one side and David Garr on the other. So one in cover and one short mid-wicket. Yeah, you had no chance. It was the best match spread of fieldsmen, I think, that it's ever lived. So I'll just
throw it. You're very kind. You're very kind.
Can you give us, just from all the time, just a highlight that comes straight to mind from or your whole career?
Mine was definitely walking out on Trent Bridge for the first time as a professional cricketer.
Wow.
With Garry Sobers. Definitely, that was my highlight of my career. Definitely. Walking across that hallowed turf that all them wonderful Nottinghamshire cricketers had walked on before. Harold Larwood, Bill Vose, George Gunn, people like this. And, you know, that was definitely my highlight of my career. Walking out there is amazing. I've never felt like that ever since, really.
Yeah, it's from people like Andrew and myself, especially as you begin to get older, and listening to you guys talk about this just over this past hour, it's been for me, it's just been a privilege to listen and to get that inside feel for what it's like, and when you're able to just come up and say, yeah, it's that first time I walk out as a professional cricketer. I can only really imagine for myself how amazing that must feel.
To me, it just meant the world, really, and I'm very grateful to have that opportunity. And I'm grateful to have a chat this morning. I really enjoyed it, Garry. Thank you very much indeed, Kieran. Very enjoyable. It's lovely to meet you all anyway.
I didn't know until I got to meet you on email a few days ago, Garry, that music's actually been a big part of your life.
Yeah, look, it has been. And it was a big part of my family.
You haven't got the 12 string there, have you?
I've got a 12 and a 6 string here, actually. I've got a 45-year-old 12 string. I've got the Yari, the Japanese Yari, which I bought about 42 years ago because I thought if you strum it, it gives a bigger sound than just a 6 string. So people tend to know that you can't play a bit. You cover it up better than a 6 string if you just strum. So I thought, go for the 12 string.
I need a 24 string.
can you strum a few bars for us?
Oh, to live on Sugar Mountain with the barkers and the collared balloons. You can't be 20 on Sugar Mountain if you're thinking that you're leaving there too soon. You're leaving there too soon.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Fantastic.
It's been fantastic to spend this time with you, with both of you guys. Thanks so much for doing this and taking the time out to have a chat today.
It's been great, Kieran. Thank you.
Been fantastic. Thank you.